Was it hard to approach some of your past lovers, and did any of them turn down being interviewed? It wasn't hard to approach people. Tracking them down, I think, was one of the things that was very difficult. And yes, some of them did say they didn't want to be involved. There were various reasons. I think partly, obviously, privacy for some people. Others weren't, just didn't like being filmed, which is something I respect. I don't like being filmed. In fact, I wasn't even going to be in it to begin with, but the Film Commission quite rightly said I had to be, and I think that was part of the process. I think there was one person in particular that I really wanted to be in the film, and he'd become a head teacher, and I think he was just worried. I mean, he was out. It wasn't that he wasn't out. He was actually married to his boyfriend, but I think he was worried about some of the questions I might ask, so unfortunately he wasn't in it. Who were your New Zealand role models when you were a kid? That's a really interesting question. When I was growing up, there weren't any out gay people to be role models in the media, certainly. And I guess in some ways it was literature where I found people that were exploring a gay identity. And I fell in love with books that I actually found in the library. I went to the sort of local library and discovered writers like Christopher Isherwood, who was a pioneer in the 50s and 60s. And he wrote about being gay, and he wrote in one of his most famous books, A Single Man, was a revelation. I remember when I read that, it was sort of dawning that, you know, gay people could lead fulfilling lives. It was fantastic. Another writer that meant a lot was a guy called John Rishi, who was again a real pioneer back in the 60s, and he wrote about cruising, he wrote about the gay experience. It was very American. So it was very much books that were role models for me. On returning from the UK, how did you find the New Zealand gay scene, and what were the major differences? I didn't come back to New Zealand to explore a gay scene, I think. I'd had plenty of that in London. I mean, the New Zealand gay scene seemed very small. And in fact, shortly after I returned, the only bar that I really enjoyed, a place called The Urge, closed down. There are other places, and you know, obviously a lot of it happens online now, and I in fact found very rapidly that I made lots of friends and the scene here was different. I don't think I expected it to be, you know, the wild, exciting time that one finds in London. I think the major difference is in bigger cities you can find places that are very specific. For example, if you want, you know, twinks, you go to a certain place. If you want leather bar, you go to another place. Whereas here in New Zealand, there's just a couple of places in the main cities and everybody's grouped together. It's just a mixture of people. Do you remember the first time you showed affection for a partner in public? To be honest with you, I don't. I certainly, growing up, it was unthinkable that one would show, you know, affection for somebody in public. You'd be beaten up. And I was beaten up in England several times, but that wasn't even for showing affection, that was just cruising. In many ways, I think I resisted the idea of showing public affection, and that's probably something that still remains. I don't feel comfortable, you know, with my partner. I would never walk hand in hand or something down the street. I think that's just something I grew up with. We're very affectionate in private, but not in public. And that's something that just perhaps remains in my psyche. Vegemite or Marmite? Not quite sure of this question. Vegemite.